to ITQA Chapter Series. So I would like to introduce you today Boaz Gülseren, who is a professor in physics at Bilkent University. And he received BS from this department in 1986. Most of you were concerned today existing. So after that he completed MS and PhD degrees from Bilkent University. Then he worked a lot of places like CISA, ICTP, Bath University, Carnegie Institution, University of Pennsylvania, NIST. So you like to travel, and it seems like you said.
Sorry for that.
So he joined the Department of Physics in 2006. His current research interests include properties of nanostructures, graphene, nanotubes, nanowires, novel 3D materials, and theory of self-assembly and self-organization, and similar topics. So he has co-authored around 19 referred papers. He has received QBTAC to us and Istanbul University Science Award. He has been elected as Associate Member of Turkish Academy of Sciences, and he has been elected full member of Science Academy, and he is the recipient of QBTAC Science Award. So thank you very much for coming.
I'm really glad to be here, and as you said, I was a student 30 years ago, and one of my professors, Maria Vijay, is here, and she her efforts on us, and so after those, now we are able to lecture, and so on. So when I received an email from you, I think a little bit what I should talk, and eventually I decided to talk on flat. Maybe you heard the word, that's the book by Abbott. In that book he described the life just confined entirely to the two-dimensional planar world. So everything was planar, you see the people as a triangular shape and so on. So today I'll try to describe a world similar to that one, but I'll show some portion, my journey inside this two-dimensional, complete planner or quasi planner work. So, but before I have to acknowledge several people who contribute here and there on different projects, and I'll present from several people today. So, with that, let me start with the graphene. So, the story actually just get excited by the introduction of the graphene. That was isolated in 2005, beginning of 2005, end of 2004. Just in 5 years, they got the Nobel Prize. So I'll try to motivate you, then I'll try to show some application that might interest to you as well, including the batteries, supercapacitors, and so on. So, let me start with the material. It's just hexagonal network of the carbon atom. Sometimes you have the honeycomb lattice, sometimes the hexagonal lattice. You see the six carbon atoms just sitting at the corner of this hexagon. Actually, we are quite familiar with this material. If you take your pencil and just look at the black part of that, it's simply graphite. Or in the old days, when you, during the winter time, you burn the coal in the ovens and so on, that's also simply graphite. So this material exists for many, many years, but what happens, in 2004, the Gaiman and Novoselov just isolated a single layer of this graphite. The graphite, it's something like that. It's actually crystalline, it's a hexagonal crystal, so it's a layer by layer structure. So if you look at one layer of this type of the arrangement of the carbon atoms, then on top of another, it goes this way, then you end up such a method. In 2004, these two gentlemen isolated, just using the mechanical means, a single layer, which I'm showing here, which is called the graphene. Why this is so exciting? First of all, the material properties. It is very light, but it is very strong, 100 times stronger than steel. Just imagine that. So if you can make a cable, then instead of using a steel cable that carries the Bosphorus Bridge, for example, you can use a very tiny cable, still have that mechanical strength that can carry a whole Bosphorus Bridge and so on. It's a very good conductor of electricity. Actually, it's a metal. So these are the standard properties. But what is important is the exotic properties. I'll try to show a couple of them. So, story might start there. Let me try to describe a little bit in detail. As I said, the same, the black part of this pencil is from a material which is the graphite, as I shown here. So it is layer by layer. So if you look at the structure, we have strong chemical bonds within the plane. This is sp2 bond, so one has two p orbitals in the planar structures. We have this covalent strong bond sp2, but if you look at the interaction between the layers, these are weak van der Waals interactions. So usually what I try to explain how to get the graphene, simply you can take your pencil, just press it your finger, and if you look at the tip of your finger, you will see some black metal. So actually you just scratch a couple of layers out of this whole structure. So that's the idea, and actually that led the Nobel Prize, that simple approach. So what this Novoselov and Ngan did, just pick the graphite, that's the crystalline structure, and take a piece of tape, sellotape, you just press with the tape, then you just peel, and try to peel softly, that eventually you get a single layer out of this multi-layer structure. This is not a joke. You can go to the bookstore, just spend the 50 kurush for the pencil, maybe 1 lira for the sellotape, just maybe 2 liras, you might end up with a million dollars Nobel Prize. It is that simple in terms of the material, but what is important here is just that idea, that ingenious idea, we should go after that creative ideas and so on. Before the Nobel Prize, I mean, this is not an unexpected thing. I mean, you can try just pressing to the pencil. You have to go after that idea and you have to realize. Before the Nobel Prize, for example, I was teaching the nanoscience courses and I was describing the carbon nanotube and so on. Just for the description of the carbon nanotube, I was explaining exactly the same way. I mean, just take the graphite, try to take one layer out, and if you roll and combine, you end up with the cylindrical shape, which is the carbon nanotube. So I mean, this was the story, goes like that, but these two guys just go to the lab and they isolated, mechanically isolated, just using the sellotape, and end up with the Nobel Prize. So it is that simple. Why that's so exciting? Let me try to explain that. So, as I said, chemically this is very simple. We have the s orbital, p orbitals that make sp2 in the plane. Then the third one is the pz, perpendicular to the planes. So just based on that orbital, if you look at the energy levels of the graphene, so it is something like that in the wave vector space. It is possible to make a simple calculation and generate the full thing. This is like a cosine function, okay? But what is exotic here, so if you look at these corners, so there are six as a shape of the hexagon, at each of these corners, which is called the K point, this valence band and the conduction band are just touching to each other, and the fan level is just passing at that crossing point. So what we know is all occupied by the electrons in the valence band, and without any gap, so it's a metal, we have the empty conduction band. So the interesting point with the graphene, if you just zoom in that point, I'm just showing here. If you look at just around the farming house here, you will see that it's entirely linear relationship. So the energy just goes linearly as a function of the wave vector here. So that makes the whole material as an interesting material. This is called as the Dirac point, this is named as the Dirac electron, because the effective Hamiltonian here and the effective equation, just like describing a relativistic electron with the Dirac equation. So there is nothing relativistic here and so on, but at that point, just at that tiny part which matters for most of the applications is just around the Fermi level, this behaves like a relativistic electron effectively. So here, if you look at the graphing literature, you will see this word massless fermions, which refers to exactly the electrons around the Fermi level here. What is the consequence of that? Actually, if you look at the effective speed, the Fermi velocity, it's quite high. So the mobility is based on these electrons around this Fermi level, just goes to the very large numbers, like 100,000, something like that, compared to the silicon, which is just 1,000. If you go to the gallium arsenide, if you push a little bit, that's just like 4,000, 5,000. So this extremely large mobility is predicted because of this special band structure here. So this is one of the exotic properties. Then there is anomalous quantum Hall effect and so on. Just because of this groundbreaking experiment regarding two-dimensional material, Andrei Geim and Novoselov, both at the Manchester, University of Manchester, end up with the Nobel Prize 2010. So, just pursue the simple ideas, but in a creative way, you can achieve a lot. So, what was achieved? Let me try to show with a couple of numbers. So I checked this from the Web of Science a couple of years ago, actually right after the Nobel Prize. So these are the articles published with the keyword graphene. So I just typed single keyword graphene. So this shows the number of the papers. So you see the first, and there are a couple of things around the material. But this is the real mechanical exfoliation. Then it goes exponential. And these are the citations, and already just 2011, already hit the 100,000 citations per year. Then it's out of the chart, and I couldn't complete the rest of the graph, and instead, I'll just put the numbers here. So these are the numbers of papers published with the graphene. You see, I mean, last year, it's already 26,000, just with the graphene. So this is very active, still a very promising material. Still, not that many people are working on this one. But this is just the tip of the iceberg, starting of the story, starting point. And actually, the story extended throughout the whole periodic table. And I will show some couple of examples. It starts with the graphene, but then the next cousin is the boron nitride, exactly the same structure, hexagonal that is, but we have the boron and the nitrogen atom, so it is the ionic. This is the metallic structure. This is because of the ionic structure, end up as like an insulator material. But then people push a lot. Then you end up, for example, transition metal decarbonized, or maxines. So different chemical combinations. There's a huge catalog of the two-dimensional materials predicted and synthesized in the last 5 years, maybe at most 8 years, something like that. So 2005 is the graphene. Then after 3-4 years, people start looking around and end up millions of things. So let me first give a couple of examples. So again, this is some combination, but let me start with the simplest one. The next thing is the boron nitride after the graphene, you just replace the carbons with the bor and the nitrogen, exactly the same like this. But it is insulated, as I said. But it has a different properties. Then, when graphene becomes that famous, people try to push to get it, some new things. The first thing, obviously, you might try is the similar structure with the graphene carbon, let's say, the group 4 elements. So I start with the graphene, graphite, but actually it's three-dimensional structure, it's the diamond structure. So just underneath we have the silicon, which is very famous for the electrode application. So people just check the silicon with the same thing. Then at that time I said, okay, it is completely different chemistry. It cannot exist. The silicon cannot make the sp2 type of the bonds and so on. But first, theoretically, this was right. When it was synthesized a couple of years after, that is the structure called the silicene, then the germanine, then these are all group 4 elements. The structure, if you look at from top, it is again hexagonal like this. But from side, you see there is this small bottling between the neighboring atoms. As I said, it cannot have the same chemistry with the carbon. There is no sp2 type of the bonds. So in the silicon, there is this planarity broken by this zigzag shape of the bonds. And this structure is stable. So this is called the two-dimensional. There is a little buckling, but all the reports, like the silicon, germany, the buckling increases when you go down through the group 4, but still they are all stable, these are all synthesized materials. And similar structure, completely different column from the periodic table, predicted for the bromine, with the bromatom as well. Similar type of the geometrical structure over there. Okay, then what else? Let's go and get different element, phosphorus. With the phosphorus, this is called as the black phosphorus, as the color suggests here. It is possible to realize a 2D structure as well. First of all, this is the layer structure, but now you see, instead of a bottling, there is a large step. So these are the pocket structures. There is a one atomic step here, so two atoms make this bond, then you go one step down, you make this type of drop, and it is possible to grow entirely two-dimensional such a metal. So you can isolate layer by layer, and this is called as the black phosphorus. There is a blue phosphorus as well, that structure is similar to the silicene one, and so on. So these are elemental ones, but this is not the end of the story. After the elements, then you look at the compounds. You try to combine different ones, bring together. So the next large family based on the transition metal atoms like the molybdenum, tungsten, and you combine with the like a sulfur, selenium, palladium. So the formula is just MX2. If you look at the structure, so these black atoms are the transition metal atoms. They make the hexagonal lattice. Then on up and down, we have the chalcogenase atom, sulfur, selenium, whatever it is. But that makes this type of the layers. And it is possible to isolate these layers, and you can get a single layer of this, again, quasi to the material. You see, the story just goes on and on. But in this regard, I'm just joking, which Chinese are very lucky. They pick the periodic table, they put the fingers on, then they try whichever the element they pick. Since they are crowded, so they can try many more. And actually, you will see it, several papers with the Chinese author predicting a new one. So this is the next family. Actually, this goes like that. You can see here the chemical formula like the one-to-one, different combination, calcium sulfide, barium selenide, and so on. But this can be a little bit more complicated and so on. Even now, we have like a titanium carbon dioxide, this type of the things, which forms the Maxine's family. So there are hundreds of new materials that might be several applications. So how you can predict? The one easy check, you can go and look at the vibrations. Okay. So here I'm just showing this family, these frequencies you see. So for example, if you look at the material, something like that, there is a negative mode, so this is a soft mode, that is unstable. But if everything is positive, for example, if you look at here, these are all vibrations are positive, so this is dynamically stable material. Then you can go to the lab and try to synthesize that material. With this approach, actually, maybe hundreds of new materials are just predicted and synthesized or being synthesized or going to be synthesized soon. Okay, so this is general introduction about the materials. So now I want to switch what we are doing with those things and how we are doing. So just one slide to that. So we are trying to describe this, just starting from the atom itself. So it's quantum mechanical, we solve the Schrödinger equation. So that's actually completely difficult many of the problems. Since once you try to solve for the wave function, you have so many electrons, just things, the Avogadro numbers, that many degrees of freedom, so that's impossible to solve because of that difficult many of the problem. But luckily there is a theory, named as the density function theory. Instead of wave function, you just describe everything in terms of the charge density, the electron density. Then this is three-dimensional world. Then you can map this complicated problem to a single electron problem. Then if you like that, effective equation, now we can solve, which is called the Kohn-Sham equations, within the density function theory, and accurately we can describe that. Now, before finalizing that, let me show this picture. This is 12 years ago. This is Walter Kohn. That's the father of this density functional theory. This photo is just in front of our building with our students. I'm looking at the students as well at that time. He got the Nobel Prize from chemistry, actually. He opened a new area in the physics. He got the Nobel Prize, and this was like from his self. So I'm just going through. So the only message here, we start with just atomic numbers, no amplitude parameters, then we solve this quantum mechanical equation and get all these properties, and I'll describe a couple of them today. So this is the list actually for my journey in the grad band. So we work on the functionalization of the graphene and the battery application. Then we look at these new materials for the battery application. I'll describe this today. We look at the supercapacitor applications, piezoelectric properties, optical properties, mechanical, so on, so on. Several things we were having on during these last couple of years. But today, I'll pick a couple of examples that might interest to the engineers like you. The first one is the battery. Actually, I don't need to show some introductory slides here. We appreciate the battery technology. And everybody at least just carrying a smartphone. And nowadays, the main problem, you start the day, then you don't have enough battery at the end of the day. Usually, I saw it's crazy. I saw people just carrying the extra batteries or the storage and so on. So this is just one example, then all these mobile devices and so on, we need the reliable, durable batteries and so on. That depends on the material. So one of the issues is that just the anode material. Here on this schematic, I'm just simply describing these alkali batteries, rechargeable batteries based on alkali metals. So most developed one based on the lithium ions. What you have on this one, you have the two electrodes and a cathode. So usually you store your metal at the anode. Then you ionize that Then you get the electrons from the outer circuit, then inside the battery, actually the diffusion of this ion to the cathode, then during the charging, you recombine that and you start over and so on. So even from this very rough description, you can guess that if the surface area is large, then you might increase the capacity of the battery. So that's the one motivation. So you need a large surface area, then you need a fast ion transport between the layers to have the efficient battery applications and so on. So in the past, the graphite actually tried for this anode material, then the carbon nanotubes, but in the recent years, people looking at the alternatives. So let me quickly summarize the process here, then I'll show some alternative materials here. So we are looking for the anode, so that's the critical electrode here. As I tried to say, in the first step, we have the ion, we have the atom, metal atom like the lithium, then you need to look at the diffusion of the metal ion. Then here you look at, you need a suitable chemical bond that will give a charge transfer from metal to the electrode itself. So you ionize the electrode, then the ionize goes one direction, the ion goes the other direction, and you get the electron to the outer circuit and take the diffusion of the ion inside the battery. But this is the basic summary of the battery operation here. So from here you can guess what we need. We need to absorb that metal ion over the electrode. Then the electron, there should be a charge transfer. Then there should be diffusion of the ion, and so on and so on. So we need to check for this new materials to have such application. So, maybe 5 years ago, we were checking the, starting from the graphite, we were checking the graphene and the carbon nanotubes for that time. Here I'm just showing one example. This is the lithium intercalation to the two layers of the graphene. So this is the bilayer of the graphene. Then we look at what is the stable geometry and what is the charge transfer. So this was a quite controversial question, both experimental from experimental studies and the theoretical studies. Some people say there is a half electron, some people say it's full electron transfer and so on. So we spent a lot of CPUs on that and calculated this charge transfer. When you look at the result, it's very simple. The lithium intercalated between these two layers, it just sits between the two layers at the center of the hexagon. So if you look at from the top, this red is the lithium ion, it just sits at the center of the hexagons between the layer, and this green is the just the electron density. That's the charge, the electron of the lithium just transferred to the carbon atom, just neighboring carbon atom. As you can see, it's actually quite uniformly distributed, almost one electron, 0.85 electron just transferred from lithium to the neighboring carbon atoms. And so on. So if there's a defect, so here we introduce a vacancy, then obviously that uniform shape is just distorted like this. The charge just transfers around the defect sites and so on. So this was difficult, and actually the capacity is not that high. So here what we try to look at the different two-dimensional materials with large surface area. So one thing, is this material, molybdenum 2 carbon. So this is just the opposite of the transition metal decarbogenase. In this case, what we have, so this is top here, these blacks are the carbons, that forms the hexagonal lattice, so there are six carbon atoms like that. That's the middle layer. Then on top and the, below that layer, we have one molybdenum atom. So formula molybdenum 2 carbon. On the carbon there, this is just like a opposite way of looking at the transition metal decarbogenase. So we check this And we try to get these two transition metal atoms up and down to interact with these alkali metals for the battery application. So we first check the stability. So these are the frequency Fonon calculations. Everything is positive. So this should be a stable material. So we predict that. And actually, last year, this material just synthesized. It is a stable material, and it is it has been used for the this battery application. So let me show what we predicted here. So we first look at the absorption of these ions. So these are the three possible sites. You can see it over the molybdenum atom, on top of this, or on top of the other molybdenum atom, this site C, or just in between on top of the carbon atom, that's site B. Okay? So we check all these and look at the charge transfer as well. So for lithium, sodium, potassium, and calcium, for three different atoms. Actually, in all cases, it gives a binding energy like a 1 electron volt, so it's a reasonable binding. And if you look at the charge transfer, around 1 electron just transferred from this metal ion to the substrate we are using here. Then we look at this as a function of the concentration, since we need to put as much as metal for the battery. For the single one, but if you occupy every possible site, so this is from the top, or if you use the back side as well, so there are two surfaces on these two dimensional materials, this is the binding energy. But you see here, the potassium and the calcium gives the positive, so they are not stable, you cannot put that many potassium. But for the lithium and the sodium, still it is possible to use this. Because of the metal-metal interaction as well. So from this, for the full coverage, actually still we can use like sodium, potassium, lithium, but the calcium is not that suitable, so that's very close to the zero. The binding is very, very weak to bind to the surface. So let me compare these numbers. So if you look at the graphite, so you can put like a 380 milliampere hour per gram. So if you look at just the monolayer or the transition metal, the calcogen is a similar number, but with this new material, this is almost double, or almost 1.5 times compared to those numbers. So the capacity is much, much higher if we use this new two-dimensional material for the battery application. So here, we see that it's fine, it donates the electron, then the other thing, just remember, this has to diffuse around the ion for the battery application. Then we check that, actually, for the diffusion. We track the different paths for the diffusion. To cut the long story short, if it goes, not straight, but it goes, just make a curvature along this red blue path, it gives a diffusion barrier like a 40 milli-electron volt for the lithium, 20 like the sodium, it's much larger with the calcium, similar with the potassium, but with the difficulty of the potassium, it doesn't find that strong. That's not that suitable for the battery application. If you compare like a 20 milli-electron, 40 milli-electron volt with the different materials, you see these are much, much higher numbers. It's almost like a quarter of an EV. So here we have a low diffusion barrier, so this offers fast charge-discharge cycles if we have this type of the electrode, another electrode for the battery. So that's also good. And then one final check is just to get the open circuit voltage that's related with the how much the material we can absorb for the lithium thing. So we can calculate that potential, and actually for lithium and sodium, actually we can use full coverage from up, top and bottom. Again, for the sodium and potassium, you can use just like a 0.5, just one quarter of the is full coverage and so on. So as a summary, lithium and sodium is a very good, if we use lithium and sodium as the alkali metal, then it's monitoring to carbon near two-dimensional structure has very overwhelming numbers for the battery application. So we predicted this from this atomistic calculation. Now these are checked, people trying to get in the lab this type of batteries. Okay. So it takes a little bit longer. Let me quickly go a second application for energy storage. Super capacitors becomes very, very popular in the last couple of years. So first, everything starts from the graphene. Now people try with other two-dimensional materials as well. So this is okay. I can skip to this introductory part, but I can summarize this simply like this. So it is like a simple geometry. In even at the freshman level, we talk about the parallel plate capacitor. But we have two metallic plates. Then we look at the potential difference between these two. Then look at the charge storage. Then we define the capacitance just based on that simple geometry. So here it is the same geometric wise. It is the same thing, but is at the atomistic. Here what we have, for example, two graphene layers, both are the metallic. At the beginning I showed the energy structure. Fermi level is just at the touching drag point. So it is metal. So if we have the two layers of graphene, the bilayer system, then we can introduce some ionic liquid between them, some dielectric. Then actually this can be used. The question is, can this be used for a capacitor, for energy storage or not. So let me show a couple of results from the graphene. Actually, what we need to look at the charge. Okay, so this is the charge. We can calculate the charge from the distribution of the energy stage, and if we integrate over the energy, we can get the charge. Then we can get the corresponding quantum capacitance and so on. So in principle, I mean, if we have the structure, if we get optimized this, if we solve the energies and levels, then we can go and calculate the charge accumulation and corresponding capacitance just based on these things, based on that formula. Here actually, I mean, we tried that. So just we start with the simple things. We take this ammonia as a simple model for the ionic liquid. This is more and more complicated, but this is one simple example. Then we check between the two layers of the graphene if it is stable, if it is possible to intercalate, and so on. Look at the different geometries. Then look at as a function of the concentration and actually they are all stable structure. Then we introduce the water and look at the solution environment. They are still stable. Then look at the distribution of the energies, and based on that, the formula I showed a couple of slides ago, we calculate the quantum capacitance as a function of the bias voltage. But this is just the Fermi energy, zero bias condition. Then actually, yes, it is possible to get the quantum capacitance out of the simple system. It is possible to store and use this as a capacitor energy storage medium. So we checked this with the graphene, and this is all already reported on the literature. Now we are looking at different two-dimensional materials for the same purposes, getting even better storage capacity and so on. But very quickly, maybe in the last 5 minutes, I'll show another application of that we recently predicted, the piezoelectric properties. You might remember the piezoelectric property simply that couples the mechanical response to the electrical response or vice versa. So if you apply that potential difference, that will deform the piece of the crystal, mechanically there will be a strain, or if you apply the strain, that will be the electric field, depending on the direction of the applied mechanical strain. So, there are several applications of this. There might be stress sensors, or one common thing is like this digital quartz. So if you look at inside, you will see a piece of the quartz crystal, actually just counting the oscillations of that, that's converted to the second and so on. So here, can we get some new piezoelectric materials? Instead of quartz or zinc oxide, that type of material. So we check with the graphene, that's not possible because of it has a full emergence method. Actually, for piezoelectricity, you have to block that center. It should be non-centrosymmetric and it should be semiconductive. So this was, okay, I'll just show a couple of slides and I'll stop that. Okay, 2-3 years ago, this was checked with the transition method decoupler and polyvalent disulfide. Two different experimental setups. So on this one, these are the two metal electrodes, and this is the suspended layer of the, this molybdenum disulfide. Then you approach with a cantilever and the tip of it, like an AFM. Then if you press, what you will do, you, that will make a bending of this layer, suspended layer. Then after this applied strain disbanding, then the electrical response just measured. Or just using the photodiode and reflection of a laser, you can look it the other way. You can apply the potential difference and look at if it bends or not. So actually that was observed and that was published in Nature Nanotechnology, and this was even published in Nature, Mother Nature Journal at the same year. On this one, this was transferred to the, some plastic substrate, and with the plastic you can easily bend and look at the electrical measurement. Just you can make a simple contact and make the electrical measurement that indeed it shows piezoelectricity. So now I'll just skip all these things. So we tried several materials. So for example, let me show here. So if you have like a chromium tellurium 2, so that's one of the highest. So if you compare, it is much, much higher than quartz or aluminum nitride and zinc oxide. So these are the well-known three piezoelectric crystals for the moment. So this exceeds all of them, and this family, especially the chrome family, just has a larger coefficient compared to these ones. Then we look at the alloying, then even when we try the, these guys, you see there are several candidates like calcium sulfide, has very large piezoelectric coefficient, might be quite useful for piezoelectric applications. So I mentioned that several things, maybe I should stop here. Even with these new materials, now we have the possibility of improving of efficiencies, storage capacities, and so on, that we might end up with the longer durable batteries, or the capacitors, or even the clocks, and so on. Thank you.